I think moving the embassy enhances the chance of peace. Why? We'll see our Arab allies in the region express unhappiness. The Jordanians, the Saudis, the Egyptians, they will feel for domestic political reasons they have to do that. But what I urged the White House, I said, listen, I think privately they'll be incredibly relieved, because what they'll say is a president and an administration strong enough to stand up to the international noise and condemnation of moving the embassy, maybe will be strong enough to pull out of the disastrous Iranian nuclear deal and stop Iran from getting nuclear weapons. So what we've seen now, the same week we announced we were moving the embassy, the president withdrew from the Iran deal, and we're also seeing we're standing up to our enemies. Appeasement doesn't work. Weakness doesn't work. What Obama practiced for 8 years, you know, there's a reason nobody here has studied at the Neville Chamberlain School of Diplomacy.
I missed that class.
The best way to deal with bullies and tyrants is from strength. And we're seeing that with Iran, we're seeing that with North Korea. Look, it's still dangerous, but peace through strength is the best way to go forward, and I'm very encouraged that the president has returned to American strength and to putting behind us, I hope forever, the practice of bowing our head and apologizing to the enemies of America.
Well, I would say, as a woman of the Jewish faith, and many of us in the room are, you standing up to put with the administration to make sure our embassy put there means more to us than I think we could ever say. So thank you so much for your strength, Senator. You just mentioned China and North Korea. We've been talking about that. There's a lot of veterans. There's actually a lot of active reservists in this room who will be affected by whatever happens in that region. And we saw the president today says that the summit's back on. I said on Fox earlier today that I think it's the best soap opera for foreign policy geeks that has ever happened. So give us your take, right? There's so much to break down, but give us your take. What can the president do in North Korea? Can he actually get to a deal on June 12th?
Listen, I don't know. I will confess, when the summit was on, when it was off, when it was on, I've been skeptical of what's going to come out of this summit to begin with. And the reason is Kim Jong-un, like his father before him, is a liar, has demonstrated he's willing to lie over and over again. The pattern that they've played repeatedly is they make lies, they'll say we'll stop developing nuclear weapons in exchange for give us billions of dollars. And America, over and over and over again, American administrations have fallen for it. And it's a little bit like Lucy and Charlie Brown with the football. So, you know, Reagan famously said with the Soviet Union, trust but verify. At a minimum, that's what I'd say for this. I'm not even sure I'd start with trust. I might just start with verify. But I will say, the best hope of improving the situation in North Korea is coming from a position of strength, coming from a position where not only are we delegitimizing, isolating, imposing sanctions on North Korea, putting maximum economic pressure on Kim Jong-un, but we're also defending ourselves in the long term, investing in things like missile defense, like THAAD missile interceptors in South Korea. And you know, one of the things, I'm on the Senate Armed Services Committee, and just last week, we passed an amendment that I introduced directing the Defense Department finally to invest and begin deploying in space-based missile interceptors, which can intercept missiles in the boost phase. That has been in development for decades, and I think it's part of dealing with rogue states like North Korea, is having the technology, if God forbid they should try to use those nuclear weapons, that we can defend ourselves and keep America safe.
So, Senator, most of the people in this room are entrepreneurs, they're in business, they're in finance. So I'll confess to you that I think a lot of us are concerned about these tariffs. Yep. It's not something as classical conservatives that would be in our ideology, so to speak. And clearly this is something, especially the negotiations on NAFTA, that will greatly affect Texas. Can you give us your thoughts on the position that the president took this week on the new tariffs and, of course, how all of this is going to affect Texas?
Well, I disagree with the tariffs. I think they're a mistake. And when it comes to trade policy, the most consistent concern I hear from the Texas business community is trade. I hear that from farmers, from ranchers, from business leaders throughout the state. Now, there's a lot that's been done in the last year and a half that has been fantastic for the business community. Tax cuts, regulatory reforms, reducing the burdens on job creators. But trade has the potential to undo a lot of those gains, a lot of those benefits. And let's take something like NAFTA renegotiation. I think that could be good or bad. It could be good if the purpose of NAFTA renegotiation, if the object is to further open up the Mexican markets, the Canadian markets, to expand trade, that would be good. That'd be good for Texas, it'd be good for the country. On the other hand, if NAFTA renegotiations are used as a vehicle for tariffs and setting up barriers to the U.S. markets and restricting trade, that's bad for America, it's bad for Texas. In the Trump administration, candidly, there are voices on both sides of that debate. This is an argument that is raging front and center in the Trump administration. I can tell you, quite publicly, I have weighed in emphatically and repeatedly over and over again with the president. But the voices that are pushing in the more protectionist direction are strong and loud in the administration. So-